can we start off just by talking a little bit about your background and how you came to playwriting?
Well, I went to New York University for their dramatic writing undergrad program, and I actually they made me an offer to stay on for one more year, and I would get my MFA. So I did both my undergraduate and graduate degree at NYU. My background in playwriting kind of oddly begins in, I grew up in Orlando, Florida, which is a very, on account of the theme parks and all the attractions, a very theatricalized place, highly artificial. And so I think that in a lot of ways was my first introduction to theater. And then in high school was reading Sam Shepard and Edward Albee and Elmer Rice and all of those playwrights who in their own ways are highly artificial as well. So that sort of is part of what brought me into playwriting.
Cool. Do you remember where your initial impulse to write came from?
To write, I mean, I don't think I was comfortable at all with writing. I was actually more of a math and science kid. I really did not like writing. And in some ways, for many years, I kind of felt like, well, playwriting is not actually writing. It's you're building a kind of blueprint for a thing that will happen in three-dimensional space. So I sort of tricked myself into thinking it wasn't actually writing. So my impulse to write came from me thinking I was not writing. Like, oh, this is a way not to write.
And what about Red Speedo? Where'd your initial idea for that come from, or what drew you to want to write this story?
I mean, I don't really accurately remember where Red Speedo began. I was trying to remember the other day what year I even started writing it, and I couldn't even piece it together. I feel like I might have started writing it several times over the course of different years. It would be something that I would occasionally spend an afternoon or two tinkering with, but not actually writing the play. I know that I started it around the time that I started swimming, so there was that sort of dumbly obvious connection to it. I knew that I was really perplexed by the public interest in sports doping. I mean, this was back when there were government hearings over the baseball scandals. Mm-hmm. And I don't particularly follow sports myself, so I was doubly confused as to why anybody actually cared. With anything that perplexes me, I have a desire to try to figure it out, try to understand it like an alien trying to understand a distant planet. That's somewhere in there it began, that I was just sort of beginning to research what the World Anti-Doping Association thought about what their reasoning was for outlawing sports doping beyond the obvious reasons.
Mm-hmm. So in Red Speedo, there's an examination of the American dream and the pitfalls of the American dream. What draws you to write about that?
I don't know that I so consciously think about the so-called American dream. I mean, even that phrase comes up in a slightly distorted way, mm-hmm. in the play. Although it is, certainly I am writing about that, and it comes out of, again, me being kind of perplexed as to, why the U.S. government cared so much about sports doping. Why you would have people like Joe Biden, before he was vice president, making public statements about how sports doping is simply un-American. And you can kind of nod your head and say, yeah, that's right, it isn't. But I wasn't actually sure what that meant. Mm-hmm. And so I guess my writing about the American dream comes out of maybe this is stating the obvious, but just sort of observing things that are happening in the particular culture that I don't understand. And since this is the culture that I live in, it's the one I'm examining and not understanding.
In a lot of your plays, you set up opposing arguments. What's your goal in doing that, not having just one argument shown or heard?
The plays are constructed out of opposing arguments simply because, well, one wouldn't be that interesting to watch, right? Mm-hmm. There would be zero conflict in a play in which all the arguments are moving in one direction, and this may be a horribly misrepresented or badly paraphrased quote from Brecht, but I recall Brecht and one of his writings talking about how a play wants to be a very, very evenly matched boxing match. And there is suspense if you really don't know which side's going to win. And similarly, in any sort of argument, I want to hear the perverse argument. I want to hear the argument that people are going to, there are arguments that we all just assume, well, that's the bad argument. And then I kind of want to say, well, what happens if we honor that bad argument and sort of make the best possible case for it? Can I make the best possible case for why we should be using performance-enhancing drugs? And so that interest in taking on the perverse side of a debate and making it very evenly matched with the counter-argument it makes for better drama, I think, mm-hmm. and suspense.
All right, I have one last question for you, and that is, what attracts you to theater as an audience member?
I mean, I think I'm a very bad audience member. I get bored very quickly. I'm not generous at all, and I'm the same with my own plays. The stuff that I'm most interested in is material that that probably confounds me at first glance, where I actually can't tell how the author made it. Plays by, say, Carol Churchill interest me because she does things in her dramaturgy that are a bit more unexpected. She's reinventing the form each time she approaches the play. Same with people like Richard Foreman, who creates incredibly complicated theatrical machines, the Worcester Group, Richard Maxwell. I like people who are reinventing the form in some way and making me, forcing me to reconsider how a play is built.